Hello and welcome to We've Been Here Before, the show that takes a nostalgic look back at long gone days when the railways were a joke, the Prime Minister was a smug toff, and George Best was out all night boozing. Let's get ourselves in the mood for a spot of reminiscing with a look back at what was going on this week in years gone by.
July 1965, President Johnson intervenes in Southeast Asia.
America orders troops into Vietnam.
July 1990, Iraq army sweep across border.
Saddam orders troops into Kuwait.
July 1981, millions celebrate royal wedding.
Prince Philip orders Charles into Diana. But here to prove that even the news is nothing but repeats these days are two teams. On one side, Gyles Brandreth, who used to be an MP, and Jimmy Carr, who hope is still a comedian. On the other side, a comedy writer who's turned novelist, John O'Farrell, and a comedy writer who's turned up tonight, David Quantick. All right, well, we're going to move into our first batch of old stories. I should warn the panel that any similarity with current events is entirely the idea. John and David, vicious thug attacks auntie. What's this story about?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Conference. Unlike many, I don't object to the mass examples of bias, both political and moral, put out by the Bolshevik Broadcasting Corporation.
So what's going on there?
Good Lord.
Well, this is another example of a government clashing with the BBC.
Yes.
Can you
have a guess of what sort of government that might
be? Well,
I
guess it might be a Conservative government because they're saying the Bolshevik Broadcasting Corporation or the Bashing Britain Corporation or whatever particular acronym.
Conservative government possibly around about the year 1917 by the belief that the Bolshevik Party still exists.
Is it the bombing of Libya, when they were very cross with Kate Adey for only describing the negative effects of the bombs on Tripoli. Where were the reports of the dancing glaziers and builders grateful for all the work they were going to be given by these American bombers?
Who was it? Which politician got it going with the attacks?
Was it Tebbit? Called them the British Bolshevik or the, you know, they generally any government that's in power has a go at the BBC. It goes right back to the general strike. In 1926, the BBC was about 3 weeks old and the BBC interviewed strikers' leaders. And it was the government were very upset about this because they said it shouldn't be going out on the radio. Of course, nobody had a radio then. It was like your show on BBC Radio 4, you know.
Well, you'll find this next question rather easy because you've already answered it. So who do you think said this?
I should be glad to receive some proposals from you for establishing more effective control over the BBC.
Kate Adey. Well, that must be Norman Tebbit then, was it?
No. You'd already sort of drifted on to the
Stanley Baldwin.
Not quite as far back as you were suggesting. Do you recognise that, Gyles? That's who might have said that? Looking for effective controls of the BBC?
That was him, wasn't it?
Yes, you can. Yeah, you can have a tick for that rather than a point. But,
can I do an impression of how this person might have said it?
Yes.
We are looking for a way of more effective control.
That's the worst Kate Adey I've ever heard.
Was it Winnie?
That was Winnie, yes.
It was Winnie.
Winnie Mandela, who was annoyed about the BBC World Service. No, Winston Churchill, quite right. That was him in 1940, and he was furious that the 13 people who actually owned television sets were being politically corrupted. And we've been mentioning Norman Tebbit. He's changed his mind recently, hasn't he, Norman Tebbit?
Oh, whose mind has he now got?
Well, he was very against the BBC, as John was pointing out about Kate Adey in her reports. But now he said this government, the current government, is, at the time of recording, is led by Tony Blair. This government is wrong to criticise the BBC. And he said, well, of course, I realise I was wrong now when I was attacking them way back in 1986 and 1990. Well, you got rapidly, almost too rapidly, to the points there. But on the scoring system, David and John get 2 points. And we go over to Gyles and Jimmy. Your question, who's making a holy mess of military intervention here?
According to what our sins have deserved, the Lord has allowed the land which was redeemed by his own blood to be defiled by the hands of unbelievers. So it is proper and just for us to provide help and advice with all our might.
I don't recognize the translation, but the gist of it I think I do get. I suspect this is Alp Arslan, who was the successor to Tughri Beg, the caliph of Baghdad, in 1071. at the outset of what eventually became the first of the Seven Crusades.
Have you been reading my notes?
Anyway, we assume...
All right.
We assume that this is an echo of, as it were, Christians versus infidels, that this is the current troubles in Iraq, going back, echoing the Crusades of 1,000 years ago.
You misidentified which side was speaking there. That was, in fact, Henry II of France speaking. And now,
but why was he doing it as though he were Jimmy Cricket?
I thought it was a very good representative of French, a Frenchman brought up in South Africa, but you misinterpreted that.
Of course, at the time, the dialect was very different. That was particularly accurate, I felt.
At the time, the broadcasters of the time also were very, very biased. I don't know if you know about the Children's Crusade that took place all those years ago. And it was a sort of outward bound venture of its day.
Duke of Edinburgh Award.
The Duke of Edinburgh Award of its time. Yeah. The Duke of Edinburgh rallied around a few thousand children and sent them off to the Middle East. Unfortunately, they didn't come back.
Crusades weren't actually started by Henry II, actually. They were precipitated by a speech by Pope Urban.
Yes.
Who's going, to have a crusade, man. and he had his cardinal, his deputy, Cardinal Suburban. And he called for, it was at Clermont, in fact, and they called for all Christians to start a war between Christian Europe and Turkey. Because they were so angry about the occupation of the Holy Land and the fact that Turkey were allowed to enter the Eurovision Song Contest.
Yes.
And this was the time when there was the first ever, this is true, protest march. Urban's successor was Pope Innocent III. Mm. His name slightly belies his reputation.
Was he second then?
And it was Pope Innocent III, it was of him that they said during the protest march, "Hey, hey, Innocent III, how many Albigensians have you interred?"
Yes.
And people hanging on going, socialist worker, socialist worker.
And so so what was the basic aim of the first, second and third crusade? What
was it souvenirs based?
Richard the Lionheart, you know, in fact was the Clare Short of the situation, because at first he was in favour, then he was against, he couldn't make up his mind, and he was the one who sued for peace. In fact, he brought about the armistice in the end.
Only because Saladin beat him, though.
Actually, he and Saladin got together.
Saladin was, of course, the ace of hearts in Richard II's pack of cards.
It was indeed, yes. And Richard the Lionheart and Henry II of France, they had to go on crusades together because they didn't trust each other. So that's the...
They wanted an exchange, weren't they?
Yes.
They
wanted
French exchange.
No, yes.
They couldn't agree who was going to drive.
Richard the Lionheart.
All right. So were there other places they had crusades to, apart from the Middle East and Jerusalem?
Oh, yeah, Bognor?
No, there were crusades in southern Spain against the actions of El Cid. The crusaders were recruited with huge banners using the slogan, "If you see El Cid, kill him." That was... But even back in the Middle Ages, Western weapons were superior to the Middle Eastern, according to one contemporary source.
Richard I had a sword of enormous dimensions with which he used to practice cutting iron bars and anvils in half, whereas the Saladins had swords which were only useful for cutting cushions in half.
So the Muslims may have suffered in the Crusades, but they wreaked a terrible vengeance in the famous battle of the John Lewis soft furnishings department. I think I better give you 3 points there, because Gyles and Jimmy had so many interesting points, so I'm boosting that. So that puts them 3-2 in the lead at the end of that round. So well done, Gyles and Jimmy. Going on to what is more to do with arts and culture, David and John, what's the grim reality behind this TV extract?
We are here all the time, and we can film you at any time, anywhere.
We've all talked it over. We know that much would be involved. So therefore, in for a penny, in for a pound, we're either going to do it or we're not going to do it. But it gives us a chance to portray ordinary people then, if you like, instead of actors and actresses on the screen.
That's the famous Royal Family documentary from 1970.
haven't the accents changed?
It's amazing. No, is the family.
Yeah.
That was the first time that many people from my background saw working class people on television, and it was really frightening.
Yes.
It was the first ever.
The first reality
first
TV.
First proper reality fly on the wall show, and it was terrifying.
The Wilcox family? Wiltons?
Waltons.
Yes, I've got it written down here and I can't remember it.
I think the Waltons was a documentary.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.